call to worship today is from Romans chapter 5 and verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. Welcome to worship at St. Paul's Presbyterian Church in Hamilton, Ontario, for this Sunday, February the 14th, 2021. It's Valentine's Day, it's Transfiguration Sunday, it's Communion Sunday. I hope that we can cover all of those themes in the worship today. I also hope that you will get some communion elements from within your own house so that when it comes time to celebrate the sacrament, you may celebrate alongside us. Please remember, the church is not closed. We simply aren't using our building for in-person worship at this time. But the church is open because you are the church. And in all the love and grace and goodness that you pour out through the week, you are the light of God. You are the church in the world. We are thankful today that Blair is with us at the organ console. We're also thankful to have all four of our section leads, Beth, Karen, Mike, and Gabriel. We appreciate their music very greatly. We're thankful that Walter is playing the chimes today and that Brandon is doing the filming and editing and that our reader is Pamela. Now, for the sake of Christ, you are all welcomed in this worship. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you in the name of Christ, our living Savior. We thank and praise you for the gift of life. We give thanks, O Lord, that you have called us into worship and into ministry. We pray that we will be the people who bring your light, your love, and your goodness to the whole world. Holy God, we pray for everyone who is celebrating Valentine's Day today, and we pray that romantic love would be good and healing and beautiful for all of those people. We lift to you those who are celebrating the transfiguration of Jesus Christ, and we pray that that moment in the life of the church will live like a bright and shining fire within us all. We are thankful, Lord, that as the Apostle Paul told us in Romans 5, you have poured your love into our hearts, and now we want to go out into the world and pour that love into the heart and soul of everyone whom we meet. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Be well assured that when we confess our sins, God forgives us, receives us anew, and calls us anew into his ministry in the world.
Glory be to the Father. Our readings for today come from the New English Bible translation, starting with Psalms 50. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes and does not keep silence, before whom is a devouring fire, around whom is a raging storm. God calls to the heavens above and to the earth, that the people may be judged. Gather to me my faithful ones who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare God's righteousness, for God alone is judge. The Old Testament reading comes from 2 Kings chapter 2. We'll read verses 1 to 12. The time came when the Lord would take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elijah and Elisha left Gilgal, and Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives your life upon it, I will not leave you." So they went down country to Bethel. There was a company of prophets came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take away your Lord and Master from you today?" "I do know," he replied. "Say no more." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he replied, "As the Lord lives your life upon it, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. There, a company of prophets came up to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take away your Lord and Master from you today?" "I do know," he said. "Say no more." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jordan." The other replied, "As the Lord lives, your life upon it, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 of the prophets followed them and stood watching from a distance as the two of them stopped by the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided right and left, and they both crossed over on dry ground. While they were crossing, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me what I can do for you before I am taken from you." Elisha said, "Let me inherit a double share of your spirit." "You've asked a hard thing," said Elijah. "If you see me taken from you, may your wish be granted. If you do not, it shall not be granted." They went on, talking as they went, and suddenly there appeared chariots of fire and horses of fire, which separated them one from the other. And Elijah was carried up in the whirlwind to heaven. When Elisha saw it, he cried, "My father, my father, the chariots and the horsemen of Israel." And he saw him no more. Then he took hold of his mantle and rent it in two. From the New Testament, Mark 9. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were alone. And in their presence, he was transfigured. His clothes became dazzling white, with a whiteness no bleacher on earth could equal. They saw Elijah appear and Moses with him. And there they were, conversing with Jesus. And then Peter spoke. Rabbi, he said, how good it is that we are here. Shall we make three shelters? One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah? For he did not know what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud appeared, casting its shadow over them, and out of the cloud came a voice. This is my son, my beloved. Or, this is my only son, listen to him. And now suddenly, when they looked around, there was nobody to be seen but Jesus alone with themselves. On their way down the mountain, he enjoined them not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. Thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word.
We're thankful to Blair, Beth, Karen, Mike, and Gabriel for that wonderful music on this Transfiguration Sunday. And we're thankful to Pamela for reading scripture for us today. Let us pray. Holy God, let your healing word come to these people now through me, or if the need be, then in spite of me, for Christ's sake, amen. In these days of pandemic, I think that we are all looking around everywhere for something that is a little bit light and a little bit uplifting, something to bring some joy to days that otherwise can be dreary. And if you're like me, once in a while you look at the internet and see what weird things are going on. And I think my favorite thing of all on the internet this week, and I hope you got to see it, was the lawyer who showed up for a trial on Zoom. But before he got to his computer, someone else had been on it and had turned on a filter that made the user look like a cat. And it was a wonderfully well done app, because the cat wasn't just a picture, it was actually moving its mouth as the man was speaking and moving its eyes and head as the man was looking around. And as the trial was starting, the judge said to him, "Do you realize that you're a cat?" And the poor lawyer said, "Yes," he said, I can see that." He said, and somebody has turned on this filter and I'm trying to turn it off and I can't turn it off." And I thought, that's about the funniest thing I've ever seen. But then, you know, it wasn't the humor of that moment that most touched me. It was the fact that I felt in the end that lawyer was the bravest man in the world. Because even though he appeared as a talking cat, he gathered himself together and he said, "I am prepared to go forward with this." And I thought, good for him. And he said, "I am not a cat." And now, whenever in my life I'm in a difficult circumstance where I don't seem to be getting things quite right, I'm going to remember that lawyer and I'm going to say, "I am prepared to go ahead with this. I am not a cat." Good for him. We have to remember in tough times what's important, and we have to remember what we are deep down inside, even if we feel like maybe we look a bit like a cat. You have to remember who you are. You have to know that so that you can go forward in difficult situations. And both of the stories from Scripture today are about people that had come to a point that was really difficult for them. And in fact, they said, "I don't think that I can go on any further." In that story where Elijah is taken up into heaven, and I pray that God will forgive me for drawing any parallel between Elijah and a cat filter on Zoom. Forgive me. But the likeness is this. Elisha loved Elijah. Elijah had been his mentor and teacher and inspiration. And now Elisha knew that Elijah was going to die. And he says, "I cannot go on without Elijah." And when the 50 prophets keep saying to him, "Do you know that your master is going to die today?" Elisha keeps saying to them, "Yeah, I know, and I don't want to talk about it." And they finally cross over the Jordan River, and Elijah says, "What could I do for you, Elisha?" And Elisha says, "Look, all I want is for you to give me your power when you are gone." Elijah says, "Well, you're asking for an awful lot, Elisha. But I'll tell you what, if you see me when I go, you will have my power. If you don't see me, then you will not." And right at that point, the chariots of fire with the horses of fire come down out of heaven and land beside Elijah. And Elijah climbs into the chariot of fire, and the fiery horses take off into the whirlwind, and Elijah is gone. And Elisha shouts after him, my father, great leader of Israel." But of course, he saw it. And then as a symbol of him receiving the power of Elijah, as he looks up into the sky, something is fluttering down to the earth and it lands on the ground. And it is Elijah's cloak, the symbol of his power. And Elisha picks up Elijah's cloak and now has his power. This is such a wonderful and powerful story, and I don't know what it means. You know, I'm not embarrassed to say I don't understand the story. I don't know fully what chariots of fire are. However, I think somewhere in there is the author trying to get across the message that even though earthly life comes to an end, we have within us an energy and a fire that is not extinguished by death in this life. We remember who we are. Elisha remembered who he was so that in a very difficult circumstance, the death of his best friend and mentor, he was able to go onwards. And the Transfiguration is a story very much like that. Jesus has said to his disciples, I am going to die. And they've said, if you die, we cannot go on. And at that point, Jesus said to James and John and Peter, why don't you come aside with me up this mountain for a few moments? And they went with him, and of course, it was there while they were looking at him that he was transfigured. Something strange beyond all description happened. He became a pure, shining light, and they were stunned and amazed. And again, I do not pretend to know what that story means. It is beyond me. But I know that somewhere in the story is an author making his profession of faith, saying, I believe that what Jesus was more than his appearance. He was, in fact, light that could not die and could not be taken away. In both of those stories, the idea is that we have fire and light inside of us. That we have inside of us some kind of an energy that is beyond the natural world, beyond our understanding, and that God put the fire there. The Apostle Paul says it in Romans 5:5, that God has put his love within our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that love is the fire of God. And we are the people who want to share that fire because we know that it brings hope and goodness and joy and wonder to everyone. The image of fire in the ancient world might have meant more to those people than it means to us. Fire was absolutely crucial to ancient people because it was the source of light and heat and the only source of cooking food. And if your fire were to go out, you were in a tough spot. Because they didn't have Bic lighters, creating a new fire was really hard. So you had to keep your fire going all the time. Rome developed an incredibly powerful plan to wipe out Christianity and Judaism. Rome passed a law which said that all fire belonged to the Roman goddess Hestia, and that no one was allowed to have any fire unless they received the fire from Hestia and had bowed down to Hestia. And that was tough. What that meant is that if your fire went out, you are not allowed to go next door to your neighbor and say, hey, I saw your light, and I wonder if you can give me some of your fire. Instead, you would have to go in the town to the Pyrtanium, the fire hall, And there the flame was guarded, and you would say, "My fire has gone out. Could you please give me fire?" And the keepers of Hestia's flame would say, "Of course you can have fire. All you have to do is bow down to Hestia." And of course, the Romans knew that the Christians and the Jews would never bow down to Hestia, and so they would be deprived of fire. And so they would instead confess Hestia, or they would die off, because without fire, there was no life. It was a perfect plan. Well, except for the fact that those human beings loved each other and were not afraid to defy Rome. So just as before, when your fire went out, the people didn't go to the hall of Hestia, to the Pyrtanium. They simply went around their village looking for a window in which there was light shining, and they would say, "I saw your light shining. May I please borrow some of your fire?" That may be why Jesus in Matthew 5:15 said, "No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket." You want your neighbors to know that you have fire and that you are willing to share it with them if they need it. We are the light. We have the light. We have the fire. God poured his love into us. Isaiah 9 says, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light." In the first chapter of John, the author says, "The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has never put it out." And in Matthew 5, "You are the light of the world. No one lights a lamp and hides it under a bushel." When Elijah is taken up in the chariot of fire, I wish I could have been there to see that, but I doubt that even seeing it would help me to fully understand it. It's a profession of faith that we have divine energy in us. I wish I could have been on the mountain with James and John and Peter and seen Jesus shining like a light, though I still wouldn't understand it. I guess I would know that it was a profession of faith. Jesus saying to them, "I am going from you, I am going to die, but please, you must see me as I truly am. I am light, and I am eternal, and you must not be afraid to move ahead." We know who we are. We are the people in whom dwells the fire of God, the fire that burned in Elijah's chariot, the fire that burned at the Transfiguration. We don't see burning chariots and people turning into light today, but we still profess the other worldly energy that powers us in the hardest times, and we know that that light and fire never runs out. What is the light? Whenever Jesus talks about the light, whenever Hebrew scripture talks about the light or the fire, it is always connected to God's compassion for all people. It is always connected to the equality of all people, the dignity and worth of all people, and the eternal worthwhileness of human existence. That's what Elijah was about. That's what the Transfiguration was about. That's what the communion table is about. And so in this time, when we are all challenged, remember who you are. Fire of Elijah is within you. The light of the Transfiguration is in you. You have light. You have fire. The work of the church has just begun. So do not be discouraged. Go and be the light of God wherever you are. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you in the name of Christ, our living Savior. We praise and adore you, O God, because you have made us in a wonderful way. Even though we are merely creatures scraped together from the dust of the earth, you have breathed your spirit into us. Your spirit is love, and it is like a fire and a light that burns independent of any source or energy that is earthly. It is a divine and eternal flame that lasts forever. Holy God, help us to be the light in the world. Help us live out our personal lives in such a way that we live for equality, for justice, for dignity for all people. Let your church be the place of equality, justice, and dignity, bringing your compassion to the world. We pray for St. Paul's Presbyterian Church, and we ask that you would allow us to find meaningful partnerships with local missions. Allow us to find new uses for the space in our buildings. Allow us to be light and hope for many. We continue to pray for a world broken under pandemic. We pray for everyone grieving the death of a loved one, for those who are ill right now, for struggling families, for children doing their best in whatever form of school they have, for lonely elderly persons, for young people deprived of all of their social outlets, for everyone working in the field of medicine towards treatment and cure, for essential workers, for business owners, and everyone whose employment or financial situation has been threatened. Holy God, allow there to be a fair and efficient and timely distribution of the vaccine, and let it bring healing to the whole world. Lord, we pray for all the people of St. Paul's and for all the people who are joining in this worship online. Bless them, O God, for the sake of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please know that next Sunday will be the first Sunday in the season of Lent, and I pray that you will join us for worship as we lead up towards Easter. Please note that We will be doing a new discussion and fellowship group on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, and that's starting in this coming week. I hope that you will join us. If you would like to, please contact the church office and they will send you the Zoom link and you can join in with our fellowship and discussion. Thanks to everyone who has continued to be generous with their offerings through the lockdown. Your gifts allow us to maintain all of our missions and ministries. Let us pray. Holy God, we give thanks for the gifts of these people, and we pray that you will use their gifts and use them in the building of Christ's kingdom of love. For his name's sake, amen. Now, as we draw close to the Lord's table, we should come to it with an understanding of how great are its benefits for us if we come with understanding, with faith, and with our hearts and souls hungering after Jesus Christ. This table is the outward sign and seal of the death and resurrection of Christ, of our dying and rising in him, of the ingrafting into God's family, the forgiveness of sins, and the new life which begins once the Holy Spirit comes in. Come to this table for the renewal of your soul and the upbuilding of your heart. This table does not belong in this world. It is a miracle that we can see it and touch it, and even taste anew the calm of sin forgiven. This is the gift of Jesus Christ to his world, that we should know him and live in his light. This table is not for those who are proud of their sin, nor is it for those who think that they are without sin. It is for those who, laboring under the burden of their sin, desire to lead a new life by the grace of Christ. Jesus said, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and humble in spirit, and you shall find rest unto your souls." Therefore, we come to this table and we set apart these elements from all common uses, and we set apart whatever elements you are using in your home from all common uses to this holy use and remembrance of God's love. night when he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Whenever you eat this bread, remember me." And in the same way also, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and said to them, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink it, remember me." "Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes again." The river of mercy which flows from the cross of Calvary. Let us pray. Holy and healing God, we come to you in the name of Christ, and we give thanks for this meal now shared in spirit with Christ and with all who love him in eternity. May these outward signs and seals of his death and resurrection become an inward reality for us, a bright shining light, a burning fire that will strengthen us, remind us of who we truly are, and send us out into the world to take your compassion wherever we go. Amen. Go in peace, You are free people. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, go with you and the whole world, now and forever.